So I'm Frank Doyle. I'm a chemical engineer, and I picked this somewhat paradoxical, maybe evocative title to speak to the exciting collision of medicine and engineering that's happening here at UCSB as we attempt to design this entity, the artificial pancreas. This has been a labor of love in my group for the last 20 years, and I'm going to try to convey to you in a very daunting challenge here what we've been doing in less than 20 minutes. So let me start with the field of engineering from which I come, which is control engineering. And I'm sure very few of you in the audience here know what that is. However, I assure you that almost all of you in the audience have experienced feedback control in your everyday lives. And I'll walk through a couple examples that illustrate that. We start with the simple process of driving an automobile. For all of you that have driven an automobile, you've done feedback control by looking out the front windshield, by collecting the information as you drive down the road, and then by responding with adjusting the steering wheel or playing the brakes and the gas pedal, you're implementing feedback control. If you use the cruise control system in your car, you're even taking that to a higher level of automation and doing feedback control of the speed using a computer chip in your car. Another example of this, perhaps more intuitive, is home heating and air conditioning system. You've got a temperature control problem, how to hold the temperature of the room to a comfortable level using the air conditioning in the summer and the heating in the winter. An example which I find fascinating as an engineering challenge is that of computer disk drive control. I've been told by the engineers who make these disk drives that the problem of holding the head over the drive as it reads your data is parallel or akin to taking the Sears Tower, the skyscraper in Chicago, turning it on its side, and holding it 5 millimeters above the ground and moving it at thousands of miles per second. This is the kind of control problem that's entailed in keeping that head reading over the moving disk drive. And speaking of flying, flight controls are abound with feedback control systems. There are about 1,000 CPUs on the Boeing 777. A few hundred of those are used for the entertainment system, and I'm sure you've all taken advantage of in-flight movies. But really, the majority of those CPUs are being used to do real-time control of critical engineering tasks on the airplane. So to introduce a little bit of the engineering technology that hides behind feedback control, I'm going to use a very simple schematic here. So this box denotes a system, and I want to convey to you the importance of understanding input-output relationships, so-called causal relationships. Cause as a stimulus and effect as the response. So on the left side, if I draw an arrow into the box, I'm referring to those stimuli, those inputs, those perturbations that evoke a response out of the system. And for that, I'll use an arrow on the right-hand side. So cause and effect, input and output. And so an example that should be very well understood to the members of the audience here, I'll use the student as a demo. So if we think of a stimulus here being the number of hours you spent studying, you might guess that the effect of that is the impact on your GPA, the grades you achieve. And of course, some of you might say the quality of the teaching is an even more important stimulus, and I would say fair enough to that. So how do we put these together to form feedback control? Well, I take three, in this case, of those blocks, and I interlace them in a circuit. I allow the input-output relationship, say, of a controller to respond to the output of a sensor and create the input that goes into a process. By that token, the process's output drives the sensor, which makes a measurement, and the output of that process drives the controller. So we create this feedback circuit that accomplishes some remarkable tasks. If we were to boil down what's going on in a feedback loop to three words, I'd use the definition sense and respond. And if you take nothing away from my lecture here today, it's that feedback control equals sense and respond, three simple words. So let's go back and look at the thermostat problem. We want to control the temperature of the room. So we interlace these three feedback elements, sense, that's the temperature sensor, and that's the controller, that's responding to that information. Respond is the heating and the air conditioning in the room. So by putting them together in a feedback loop, this is very powerful. We can accomplish things like, for example, holding the temperature of the room on a target, keeping it at a comfortable, say, 70 degrees. Despite the fact that we have perturbations. It's a hot day outside, it's a cold day outside, 100 people came into the room, the windows are open, the doors are opening. Despite all of these perturbations, this marvelous feedback loop keeps, through the action of the controller, the system on the target temperature. So that's the power of feedback control. Now I want to transition into the more medical part of my talk. And to do that, I've chosen this piece of art from Fritz Kahn. He painted this in 1926. This is hanging in the National Library of Medicine in Stuttgart, Germany. And his painting is entitled Der Mensch als Industriepalast, The Body as a Chemical Factory. And he was choosing to illustrate at the time the remarkable complexity of the digestive process and the respiratory process, and likening that to engineering technology. And while there are a host of things happening in the field of medical engineering that address artificial organs of all types, I'm going to focus my attention on a little portion of his diagram right here, which is the pancreas. And the function of that pancreas, one of the primary functions, is to secrete insulin to manage blood sugar levels. And when this goes awry, when this is not working, of course, we wind up with diabetes. And diabetes is a major global problem. This is the only major disease where the death rate is rising. In the US, the incidence of death from HIV and breast cancer combined are exceeded by diabetes. It's also the only major disease where the death rate is, in fact, rising. So if we look at across the world, there's close to 400 million people living with diabetes. About half of them don't even know it. They haven't been diagnosed. And the cost here in the US of coping with diabetes and the complications of diabetes and the lost productivity resulting from that exceed $200 billion per year. It's a big problem. So if we put this in the concept of a feedback loop, let's go back to thinking about how this works in the body of an individual who does not have diabetes. The feedback system could be schematized this way, where we have the pancreas, which is the controller. The pancreas uses two clusters of cells, alpha cells and beta cells, to secrete two hormones, glucagon and insulin, respectively. Those hormones influence the human body in a way that affects the blood sugars, which are detected by so-called glucose receptors on the cells. That information then stimulates the production of insulin and glucagon in the pancreas. So that's the natural feedback system. And how well does it do? Well, it does extremely well, particularly in the face of things like disturbances. In the case of our body, a disturbance to the blood sugar might be a meal, ingesting carbohydrates. It could be exercise. A mild amount of exercise depletes your blood sugar. A more intense bout of exercise might actually lead to glycogen conversion, generating more glucose and elevating your blood sugars. So it's a very complex feedback loop. If we look at an individual who does not have diabetes and what their blood sugars do over the course of a day, we might get the following plot. This is a 24-hour trace of one of my students who wore a sensor that was measuring his blood sugars every 5 minutes. And what you see here is a remarkable flat line. This is one of the cases where a flat line in medicine is actually a good thing. His pancreas is doing remarkably stable control of the blood sugars and holding them very close to a target value here. Despite the fact that this was a Friday night and in the evening here, he was out doing the kinds of things students do in Isla Vista, enjoying pizza, enjoying beer, and yet his pancreas was hard at work to keep his blood sugars rock steady, the power of that feedback loop. Now, in the case of an individual who has type 1 diabetes, that loop is broken. The loop is no longer closed. And that's because the immune system attacks the pancreas, specifically attacks the beta cells, and the pancreas can no longer produce insulin. So we no longer have a closed feedback loop. We no longer have the sense and respond mechanism that we talked about earlier. So now, when one eats meals, for example, blood sugars elevate. We have a so-called hyperglycemic state. And because the pancreas is not secreting insulin, blood sugars stay elevated. And individuals with type 1 diabetes have to administer either through shots or using an insulin pump their own insulin to combat this hyperglycemic state and bring the body back down to target. But that's not an automated feedback control system. The problem is when somebody is left to their own devices to manage their diabetes, they have a fairly chaotic, very noisy, stochastic looking trace of their blood sugars here. This is data from one of our subjects I collected when I first moved to Santa Barbara over the course of a month that shows you these widely varying blood sugar concentrations. If you look over the course of the month, they only spend about half the time in this green zone. That green zone is the so-called euglycemic zone, the range over which the doctors consider their blood sugars to be in decent regulation, meaning complications to be minimized. However, they spend about 25% of their time in an elevated state, so-called hyperglycemic state. In that hyperglycemic state, they basically have impaired control of the blood sugar. Everywhere that the blood flows is impacted. So throughout the vasculature, the eyes, the kidney, the nervous system, all impacted. And that leads to the long-term complications of diabetes. Even more challenging is when we leave the lower bound of this green zone, we have some more immediate consequences. Now we're robbing the brain of fuel. Now we can impose and potentially cause a more immediate hypoglycemic, low sugar, coma state, or even worse. And in fact, there's a red line here at 50 milligrams per deciliter, below which we have really a very high threat of a serious hypoglycemic incident. And that happened roughly 20 times a month for this individual. So a serious problem. Now, if I take all this data and I characterize it in terms of the time spent in the green zone, it was only about half the time. Roughly a quarter of the time, this person was in an elevated state. And roughly a quarter of the time, this person was in a hypo or reduced state. So very dangerous situation if left to their own devices to manage their blood sugars. So let's go back to our feedback control policy, sense and respond. I want to show you that we have technology these days that allows, for example, automatic sensing with a frequency of every 5 minutes. This very tiny device, about the size of a flash drive, can measure blood sugars. It's adhered to the abdomen or part of the body with a very tiny needle and reports back to a remote control where the subject can monitor their blood sugars. This technology is available today. On the respond side of the system, there are insulin pumps. This is one example of something called a patch pump. There are no tubes, there's no wires. This is adhered, again, to the abdomen or the thigh or the arm. And this has on one side an insulin chamber, on the other side a battery pack. And this can then remotely, with no wires or tubes, administer the insulin over the course of several days. Other categories of pumps include the pumps like this, where there in fact is tubing. There's a needle that's inserted under the skin, and then the pump can be worn, for example, on a belt clip. So this technology is available today. What's missing is that little three-letter conjunction in the middle. These things are not connected. We don't use the information from the glucose sensor to drive the insulin pump. And so this is where the opportunity is. And in my lab, we've been focusing on that little three-letter acronym and the linking, the control part, the feedback control part of the problem here. So if we put this in the context of our feedback control cartoon, now we can take an algorithm in the green box here, our controller, that responds to a target blood sugar level. It uses that information to drive an insulin pump connected to the body. That will affect the blood sugars in the body, which are measured by the sensor, report back to the controller. And just like our thermostat example, we've got all the benefits of doing feedback control. We've got a target glucose level, which can be input to the controller. We can combat disturbances like meals and exercise, stress, illness, all these things show up as perturbations on the system. But the feedback controller is able to keep the system locked in, controlling the blood sugars to a steady value. If we go under the hood for a moment and I tell you a little bit about the algorithm, we'll blow up that green box now and we'll go into a little bit of the details of how that calculation is done without using any math here. So again, we're responding to a target glucose level and a measured glucose level. The two may not be the same. In fact, when they're not the same, this drives the calculation to figure out how much insulin should be delivered. This is done through using the measurement, some measure of health, the quantified health, how close to target the individual is. And at the core of this is a mathematical model. Hence, we call this model predictive control, the class of algorithm that we're using. And this uses a mathematical model to forecast into the future what the blood sugars are going to be on the basis of what's been happening in the past, the previous insulin administration, the previous meals, the previous exercise, forecasting ahead what the blood sugar should be. That information, along with things like limitations on the insulin pump, the pump can't take insulin back out of the body. The pump has a finite upper bound on delivery rates. If I factor all that information in, I can compute a so-called optimal insulin rate. And I can compute this out into the future. However, I only implement the very first move because I'm going to collect new glucose information and repeat the whole process again every 5 minutes. So if you think about it, predicting into the future several moves, only getting to make one move and then repeating the process. This is very much like the game of chess, right? The chess masters forecast several moves ahead, but they're only able to actually implement the first move because then the opponent makes a move. Here, the opponent is that measurement, the changing demands in the body, and the game gets reset and a new calculation has to be done. This not only is a powerful strategy for chess, but it's actually the way that petroleum refineries are operated and have been since the 1970s. They've used the model predictive control paradigm as a way of managing complex operations in something of the magnitude of an entire oil refinery. So, are we the first to think about this? Certainly not. In fact, folks have thought about this idea back in a time that predates the birth of most of you in the room here, back in the early 60s. In fact, one of the first realizations of an artificial pancreas was by a gentleman named Arnold Kadish. He's an engineer from Beverly Hills. 1964, he had this idea of an artificial pancreas that looked like this, a fairly cumbersome apparatus with tubes that were actually connected intravenously into a system. Not exactly a portable solution. In fact, if I share the detail that there's a 12-foot extension cord hiding in the background here, this is really not an ambulatory solution. But it's the beginnings of thinking about trying to find a merger of technology with a medical problem to effect a solution. Flash forward to the present time, and one can literally say there's an app for that. There are people who are working on cell phone platforms, on tablets, trying to come up with calculations that can be used as the basis of that feedback controller. And how this actually looks, for those of you in the back of the room that couldn't see my demos earlier, this is what it would look like with a real pump attached to a subject, their glucose sensor also attached, and then the algorithm is working behind the scenes. It's that invisible technology connecting the two devices. So in real time, we're updating, we're revising the calculation of insulin on the basis of what that measurement is from the glucose. So how does this do in practice? Well, we've been running clinical trials from about the time that I moved here to Santa Barbara, almost a decade now, with the very clever medical doctors at the William Sansom Diabetes Center right downtown. And we've had some remarkable successes. I share with you just a couple snapshots from some published clinical work we did. And I want to draw your attention to that green zone number. Remember, somebody on their own achieves roughly half the time, 55% of the time, management within the green zone. Now, if we release all of their human interventions and let a computer chip do the work, we can actually hold them in the green zone 70% of the time. And this was repeated with a different algorithm where we got it as high as 86% of the time overnight. We stayed in that nice, tight euglycemic zone. This was all done under the very carefully controlled conditions inside a clinic with a doctor and an engineer hovering over the patient. What we really want to do is move outside the clinic, and over the course of the last year, we've been doing that with some so-called outpatient studies. These are examples of our patients. Here they are downtown Santa Barbara enjoying a lunch. Here's one of our subjects stopped in the Apple store on State Street and used the cloud to check their data, see how their artificial pancreas was doing. Here's some of our subjects enjoying a dinner at Arnoldi's, a local Italian restaurant here in Santa Barbara, and playing a little game of bocce ball after dinner. So these subjects are getting out and having an everyday realistic experience. And if we look at the trial that we have been doing for the last basically year and a half, we have a 26-hour window where they are out in the real world, enjoying meals, enjoying staying in a hotel, and having the artificial pancreas manage their blood sugars. And the results have been really impressive. Here's a trace that shows you a data run from one of our subjects. That nice flat line that we talked about for a healthy individual is now being achieved for a person who has type 1 diabetes. And again, if we look at the green zone numbers, during the entire closed loop, we're roughly 80% of the time in the green zone, and overnight, a remarkable 92% of the time. Now, the statistics are remarkable in and of themselves, and engineers love numbers, but what's really exciting about this work and endearing for us is the impact it's having on the lives of our subjects. We've got some wonderfully clever, creative, and very collaborative subjects here in Santa Barbara that have been working with us on the artificial pancreas. They call it everything from their spa day to helping balance their system. It allows them to spend more time with their family, less time managing their diabetes. And it's very exciting. We're just scratching the surface. In this paradigm of sense and respond, there are new ways to do sensing that are being explored by the research community, new ways of delivering insulin and other hormones that are continuing to be developed, and of course, new algorithmic innovations. So the sense and respond paradigm will continue into the next generation of devices. So I'm Frank Doyle, and my lab is developing the artificial pancreas.